I want to welcome you once again to the Cumberland Presbyterian Church, all who are present with us this day, as well as we want to welcome all of those who are listening to us as we live stream. And also, once again, we want to encourage you to listen. If that is not working for you, you have another option. Someone stopped by the church office this week, and I showed them exactly how to do it. If Facebook Live does not work for you, then go to YouTube. Or go to our website. You Google website for Bowling Green Cumberland Presbyterian Church, it pulls it up. And there are all these links across the top of the page. You hit the one that says program. Program will then pop up current month series, sermon archives. You hit current month series, and the service of that day will pop up. It takes 3 or 4 hours after live streaming this service. It takes a while for Jeff to post that on YouTube. But the person said they were having difficulty hearing it on Facebook Live. I sit this person down who has hearing aids in my chair. I made them go through step by step. And once she did that, you can adjust the volume to any level you want on your home computer. So if you have a computer, that is another alternative way to watch the service. Facebook Live, you can see it as it's recorded. And also, the church session voted to update our live streaming equipment. We're in the process of getting quotes, and so that not only will it live stream to Facebook, it will also live stream to YouTube exactly as we are in worship together. So just bear with us. We're all trying to work on these details together. Also, the flowers on the altar table this morning are given in memory of Willard Coe's parents, Kirk and Audrey Coe, given by Willard and Marion Coe. Also, just want to share with you this Tuesday at the Medical Center, Bill Matthews will undergo surgery this Tuesday at the Medical Center. Also, Mary Catherine King remains in Christian health care in the rehab part, and her husband, Harry, remains at the Christian Health Care Center in the bridge part of that. Once again, if you're planning on coming to worship next Sunday, this Tuesday night, our task force is going to be meeting again because our governor has changed our seating capacity to 50%. Our task force is going to be meeting so that we can make all the adjustments that we can so we can have a maximum number of people in here, as well as evaluating and looking at everything that we have been asked to do in the past. So we want to encourage you to bear with us. It's always a hard task when you're put over this, but we're doing the best we can. And so our task force, if you're on it, we're meeting Tuesday at 5 o'clock at the church office building. Any other announcements or any other sickness or anything one would like to share? If not, we're glad that you're here. On graduation Sunday, we will honor our graduates. And as we begin our morning worship, let us begin with these words found in the 3rd chapter of the Book of Lamentations, when the prophet writes, "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me." So come, join with me as we worship the Lord.
Thank you.
praise your holy name. As we come together, O God, this day, we offer up our prayer and petitions to you on the behalf of all who are gathered, as well as all who are listening this day. We pray, O God, as your servant leader, and we know, dear God, that as we pray on behalf of others, that you are already aware of what our fears, our concerns, our burdens, our losses, our doubts, our hopes, and our joys and dreams and our needs are. We know, O God, that you understand our suffering and pain. So we give all of our brokenness to you and ask, O God, that the power of your healing touch be upon our lives this day. And may your healing grace reach into the depths and recesses of our soul. We ask now, O God, that the words of your scripture and the teachings of your Son, Jesus Christ, be a light to our path and a lamp unto our feet. And may always say and do, honor and glorify you. For we pray in the name of the one who is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end.
Oh. socioeconomic backgrounds to promote diversity. And that week I had middle schoolers, and I had a kid named JoJo. And JoJo, as he liked to be called, we had a food fight at the end where all the kids got messy, and somebody did something to JoJo. And so he started swinging, and so I had to grab him, and he didn't want to go, so I just picked him up and carried him away. And he's sitting there, and I'd heard about JoJo's home life and all that the whole week. So I knew where he was coming from, and I knew what his family was like, and all that. And he's sitting there, and he's kind of grappling a little bit. He's I said, JoJo, look at me, buddy. Just look at me. Here's the thing, buddy. Every day when you wake up, you have a choice. All right? I know what your family is like. I know what your home life is like. But every day you have a choice. We talked about Jesus all week, buddy. Every day you have a choice. And you can choose to follow Jesus, to ask for his direction. Or you can choose to do it your way. But I'm going to tell you, your way got you here. So maybe we need to rethink things. Now, the guys that have graduated, girls that have graduated, some of you are graduating high school, some of you are graduating college. With that, you have more independence than you really ever did before. And so every day, you have a choice. Some of these choices are going to be the toughest choices you've ever made. And when you're making these choices, think about the values that this church has instilled. Think about the values that your family has instilled. And instead of going your own way, lean on God and lean on us, because we'll always be here for you. Now, for those who are here, I have gifts. We could give one round of applause for our class.
Oh.
the writer writes these words. So Elijah got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he traveled for 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. And there he went in the cave and spent the night. And the word of the Lord came to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he replied, "I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, broken down your altars, and put your prophets to death with a sword. I'm the only one left now, and now they're trying to kill me." The Lord said, "Go about and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. There is a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not found in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not found in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. After the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face, and he went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. And the voice said to him, 'What are you doing here?'" We ask now, O God, that all the meditations of our hearts and the words of thy servant find acceptance in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. For it's in his holy name we humbly pray. We live in an age today where there are these always on devices. And these always on devices, they are always listening and sending out information to the cloud and to other things. Your smartphone, your smart TV, your smart appliances, all of these things. Alexa, always on, always listening. But the irony for me, when you start to think about all these devices that we now have that are getting smarter and smarter all the time, they are always listening and invading more and more portions of our lives. But have you noticed the better that all of these devices are getting, our culture is getting worse at this. It's literally true. The doctors have reported that millennials are 30% more, have a 30% more increase for premature hearing loss than any other generation before them. But not only is this true of this kind of hearing, this is also literally true for the hearing which distracts our ability to hear in the nature and the recesses of our soul and being. I know this to be true for me personally in my own home. Ask Faith, "Is your husband afflicted of any sort of disease?" And she would probably tell you, "He is guilty and he is diseased with selective hearing disorder." That he only hears what he wants to hear. Anybody else here have a spouse or a sibling or a co-worker that is guilty of selective hearing disorder? Well, if you are, I got a solution for you. Look right here. You can go out and buy you one of these big ears. You can buy two of them. You can buy a set of big ears. And you can wear them around the house, and maybe they will enable you to listen more effectively and better. And yet the truth of it is, we know that not to be the case. Many people also believe in the world in which we cranking up the volume is not the solution either. So what is the solution for us being able to listen and hear more effectively? In order for us to think about that, I want us to turn to a biblical character who's experiencing some premature hearing loss in his own life, and perhaps even selective hearing disorder. And that man's name is the prophet Elijah. Now, a little bit of background about our text this morning. Elijah has just been out on Mount Carmel, and he has just defeated all the prophets of Baal. He is a conqueror, he is victorious, and yet as soon as this is all over, he begins to be a man on the run, scared for his life, because Queen Jezebel is after his skin. So Elijah runs, fleeing for his life, because as he flees, he cannot feel the presence of God, but he's at the same time, he's trying to hear, and he's trying to listen for God. And so what does Elijah do? Elijah goes to the very place that he feels that he can listen and understand God clearly in the most profound way. And so Elijah, according to our scripture text, goes to a place called Mount Horeb. Now you will not know that mountain much, perhaps, but you will have heard of Mount Sinai. Mount Sinai is that place, that mountain, where Moses received the Ten Commandments. It's that place where God showed the most direct communication with not only Moses, but his people. And this is certain, this certainty and the volume is exactly what Elijah's looking for at this point in his life. Now we're all familiar with the story, and Elijah is depressed. Any of you, have you ever been depressed? Well, one of the things that depression always causes for us is that so oftentimes we're in our emotional state is in a state of depression. It drastically, believe it or not, affects our ability to listen to God and to others. And so according to the text, what does it say Elijah's doing? Elijah's gone back to doing the basics of life. It says that he's sleeping, he's eating, and he's drinking, and he repeats this over and over again. And so Elijah restores a baseline and finds his way as he clambers up to the top of the mountain, that place where he knows God is so demonstrative that God will indeed speak to him. And God does speak to Elijah. But God speaks to Elijah in a way that he doesn't expect. Because when Elijah gets there, God says, "Elijah, what in the heck are you doing here?" And I want you to notice that God asked Elijah a question. And so if you're in a relationship with God and you experience that God only speaks to you, and when he does, it ends with an exclamation point or a period at the end of the sentence, I got news for you that when God, the Bible, the living God of the Bible speaks to you, he's probably going to ask you some questions. And believe it or not, throughout the scriptures, God asked over 3,000 questions. And so when God asks those questions, we can come to God with our questions, and God will give us an answer, but God always asks us questions because he wants to examine our hearts and life. I will go over all 3,000 questions that he asks, but here's just a few. Adam and Eve are out in the garden, and God comes and says, "Where are you hiding?" Cain, he speaks to, says, "Why are you so angry?" To Abraham and Sarah, says, why are you laughing? And to Moses he says, what is that that you're holding in your hands? Over and over again throughout the scriptures, in the old and in the life of Jesus, Jesus would ask questions of people because he wants to hear from you. And when Elijah actually answers God's question, you have to give him one thing. He's honest. But when he's honest about himself, Elijah also reveals to us that he is incredibly self-righteous. Did you notice what Elijah answered back to God? When God said, Elijah, what are you doing here? Whoa, I'm so glad you asked, God. And what does he do? He says, God, don't you know how zealous I've been for you? Don't you realize how faithful I've been for you? Do you not know I'm the only one left that's still keeping the faith? And so if you think being depressed can affect the way you hear from God, let me tell you, folks, self-righteousness will deafen the voice of God as well. So we can let things happen in our life that affect our ability to listen in our soul. And so what does God do? He did what Jordan does up here at Children's Moment. He says, I think it's time to give an object lesson. We're going to do a little experiential learning here, Elijah. And so what does God do? He says, Elijah, you go outside this cave and you stand on the edge of the mountain. And Elijah does what God asked him to do. And you heard it in the story, there's this great storm, and the rocks begin to shatter, and Elijah's looking for God everywhere in the midst of the wind, but he does not find God. And the same thing happens when the earthquake comes. Elijah's looking everywhere, and he finds God nowhere. And the same thing happens with the fire. And if you ever thought about this, it just come to me. There's all these manifestations of God which are always symbols in the Old Testament of earth, wind, and fire. And that was long before the rock band in the 60s. But why does God use these symbols? God uses the trio of these three symbols because they were the way in which people recognized God's manifestation. They were the ways in which God's people had experienced the presence of God in their life. Recall with me. Do you remember when God was leading them from the wilderness to the promised land? He led them by a pillar. A pillar of what? Of fire. And yet in this text, God's not found in the wind. He's not found in the earthquake. And he's not found in the fire. But the text tells us how God revealed himself. It says, God whispered. With a gentle whisper, God was to be found in a gentle whisper. And if you're like me and you grew up reading the King James Version of the Bible, what it really says is that God was in a still, small voice. And so in this scripture text here, it seems God's not out to impress anybody. And it also seems to me that God wants us to know that he's not always found in the spectacular. But God wants you to understand, and all of us to understand, it is that the medium is the message itself. whispers to you because God wants to be close to you. Because God wants to draw near to you. I don't know about you, but I discovered this with my own children as a parent. Did you ever notice when you were parenting or giving instruction or whatever to your children, the louder your voice would get, your children would do what? Tune you out. But take your spouse to the kitchen and try whispering something in their ear to your wife that is a secret, and your children lean in and they dial in at that moment. Because they were listening. And God wants us to know there's something important about lowering the volume so we can hear. If I could give the graduates a set, all of the graduates that ever graduated from the church, I'd give you a set of books called Chronicles of Narnia. You will know one out of it, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. I have those books and I read them over and over again. They're actually children's books. One of my favorite in that collection is a book called The Horse and the Boy. And there's a little boy in this book and his name is Shasta. And he grows up in a home where he is abused and he flees for his life. Now what's the parallels here between this little boy and C.S. Lewis's book about the Trinity of God and this little boy in a children's book? The little boy learns his abusive father is going to sell him into slavery. So you know what he does? He flees for his life. And when he flees for his life encounters a life of adventure. He encounters talking horses. He meets a new friend named Arvius. And he finds out that he's got a secret twin in the world that he knew nothing about. He's given an incredible mission to warn the king. But when you read this book, you discover that there are parallels in this book to the life of Elijah. And these lions are out there chasing him. Then all of a sudden, Shasta feels this deep breath come over him. And what he does is, you know how many times the lion speaks to him? Not once, not twice, but three times. But Shasta was afraid of the lion because of his loud voice. And at the end, almost near the end of the little children's book, you know what the lion does? The lion says, Shasta, the story I tell is your story. And the lion leans in and he whispers. He whispers into Shasta's ear. My dear friends, if God doesn't speak loud enough for you, maybe there is a reason. Maybe the reason is because sometimes when God speaks to us in that hushed nature of his voice in a whisper, what's really happening is God's trying to draw close to us so that we can hear what God has to say. Maybe God asks questions sometimes of us instead of giving us answers. But you know why God does that? God does that so we can grow. Maybe God is not always in the spectacular because God is not always in the business of trying to impress you. And sometimes, when it seems that God is mute and God is quiet and he does not speak. You may think it is that God does not care. And it's really quite the opposite. What God is trying to do is when he whispers to you. I love what Jordan said to the graduates about each day you have a choice to make, graduates. And what I will say to you is that when you move forward in life, don't always look for God in the modern day equivalents of earth, wind, and fire. But realize that the way God may choose to speak to you so that you will listen is that he whispers. Because I don't know about you, but when someone whispers, the only way I can hear them is if I'm close to them. And the only way you'll be able to hear God in your life, if he whispers, is if you're close to him. So I encourage not only the graduates, but I encourage us all to listen for the voice of God as he speaks to us so often in the gentle whisper. The Bible doesn't say that God so loved the world that he tweeted. It doesn't say for God so loved the world that he lost a PR campaign. What it says is, for God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son. Think about that. The very incarnation of God in a little baby named Jesus. A king comes to the world in the gentle whisper of a little child. I don't know about you, but that might be the gentlest whisper I've ever known. Let me ask you something. Stop and think about it. When you were dating your girlfriend, or now your spouse, the very first time they told you they loved you,
did they yell?
No. They leaned into you as they drew close to you, and in a gentle whisper, they said, "I love you." And what God understands about us that we don't often even understand about ourselves is that some messages that God has for us cannot be shouted. They must be spoken to us. They must be whispered. And remember, the reason God whispers them to us is because in order to hear, you have to be close to God. As I thought about all the noise in our world today, I thought about the time in my life when I was growing up. It was a very noisy time in the world. It was after the assassination of a particular civil rights leader, and I remember this as a teenager. I remember witnessing the funeral of Martin Luther King Jr. It was only a private gathering of close friends and family, held in a little chapel called Ebenezer Baptist Church. And all the noise of the world was going on around me. But what I remember about that service is this one thing. That inside that church, when all the noise of the world was there, they were singing these words. Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. We still live in a noisy, noisy world. And maybe we've come here this morning into this sanctuary. And what you've discovered here is that maybe you have select here. Maybe you have some premature hearing loss, spiritually speaking. But what God is saying to us is this. He's still quiet and calm your soul. Because sometimes when God chooses to speak to us, it's not in earth, wind, and fire. But whatever it is that God has to say to you, he gently whispers in your ear. And remember, if you don't remember anything else, in order to hear, you must be close to God. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this prophet Elijah. We thank you, oh God, that we're able to look at this experience in his life. We're grateful, oh God, that it helps us to understand that God doesn't speak to us in one particular way, but that the message that God has for our life is often spoken to us through a gentle whisper. We ask, oh God, now that you quieten our souls, that you sharpen our spiritual senses. And whatever the message is that God has for us this day, and that message could be different for everyone here, we pray, dear God, that as you whisper it to us, that we'll draw close to you, that we will listen. For when you speak, we know, O God, that you always want what is best for us. So speak to us now in these moments, or as in Christ's name we pray. I thought what better song to sing at the end than that song I remembered when I was almost 16 years old. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling as we stand and sing that verse from that great hymn. out into the world, always remember that the world in which we live in needs the light of Christ in our life to shine. For wherever light shines, darkness cannot exist. Will you join with me in our responsive benediction? Let your words this week proclaim God's love. May your heart's meditations be acceptable to God.
We seek to let God light our tongues. We want to speak without arrogance or false pride.
Listen for the wisdom that God wants you to know. Seek God's counsel and reproof each day.
We will look for God in the midst of creation. We will see God's face in the people around us.
The heavens are telling the glory of God. God's hand is outstretched to touch and heal you.
How good it is to sense God's guidance. How exciting it is to follow where Christ leads.
If you'll remain standing, our ushers will usher you out. And once again, like I say, we'll be issuing you a phone tree this week, giving you all the updates about our services. And once again, you can grab the